Hey guys, Stephanie here from ProjectLifeMastery.com. I'm here with my brother Andreas, and in this interview we're going to talk about how Andreas has been able to scale up his Kindle publishing business to up to $21,000 per month in 1 year. Now, we did a similar interview like this a few months ago, I think.
Back in end of August.
Yeah. So quite a while ago. When you had first gotten to Kindle publishing, and I think at that point, 4 months in, you did about
6,500.
Yeah, 6,500 within 4 months. And now he's been able to scale it up over the last year up to $21,000, which is just incredible. He's taken it further than I've taken it and further than pretty much anyone that I've ever seen that has gotten started with Kindle publishing or K-Money Mastery or any other method out there. So we thought we could do this follow-up video. It's been exactly about 1 year since you started this whole venture into making money online, internet marketing, and no experience previously with that. In fact, if you watched the previous interview, you'll know a lot of his story. We went into how his upbringing and how he became successful in a construction business here in Vancouver, making that transition into the online marketing world, starting a brand new career, knowing nothing about it, nothing in terms of any background on computers or technology or anything like that, and just being able to build it up to this point. So if you want to know more about the story, go back to that previous video. But in this video, I thought we could talk a little bit about your journey since then, what you've been able to accomplish in this year and how it's changed your life. So do you want to maybe start off just by sharing with people your results, the last year?
Yeah, it's been completely awesome. I don't think I could have done any better. When I look at what I'm publishing now, it's night and day compared to that first 4 months.
Yeah.
I'm making so many mistakes,
right,
even now. And I can't imagine with the things I know now, I would have progressively done better even in the first 4 months. But of course, it's all a learning curve. I was able to implement and learn from my mistakes quicker than most people, just because of my experience growing up in regards to everything we talked about in that last video of where I am today in construction and all my other ventures. In regards to Kindle and CreateSpace and Audible, I've had huge success in regards to all three. Audible is...
Before, by the way, you only were doing Kindle publishing, right? Were you doing CreateSpace back?
Yeah, back the first 4 months. I didn't get into CreateSpace until probably a month after we got into Kindle. So I had left a lot of money off the table. But I was focused on just automating the Kindle business, which allowed me to grow from 6,500 to I think about 13,000 last month. And so then I got into CreateSpace in September, a little bit later in September, and that business is actually going to grow bigger than Kindle. I kind of felt CreateSpace had a bigger potential, just because there is so much more options in pricing things much higher than Kindle. Kindle's so sensitive on the pricing.
Yeah. And just to be clear, CreateSpace is turning your Kindle book into a paperback book.
Exactly. And so I found a strategy in regards, when publishing paperbacks, that the more content that you have, you actually can charge a lot more money. People spend a lot more time researching on CreateSpace, in Amazon for paperbacks, because it's a little bit of a bigger investment. They're getting a physical copy, so it's a little bit different than just downloading a book. And with the KUU program, it makes it very easy for people just to download the book and forget about it, possibly never even to come back to that inventory of books for months down the road. But a physical copy, they're going in there and buying the print version. They pretty much want to read it when they get it. They're waiting, a week or however long it takes to ship. Here in Canada, it could take us a couple weeks
US
to get it.
Like the few hours later.
Yeah, you'll get it, right? But they're excited. They're getting a physical item, a physical product. And you got to remember that a majority of the population today still is from the baby boomer era. Mm-hmm. And they're the traditional people that like to buy physical copy. And I think that's where the misconception is yes, the trend is going towards everybody buying online, digital, things like that. But we still have a large population, the majority of the population that are our parents and grandparents, they still like the physical copy. They're not going to have a Kindle or Kobo. Some of them will change and adapt because they're forced to.
Even a lot of the younger generation too, they haven't made that... they haven't adapted yet to the Kindle yet, and you're still buying a lot of paper.
Well, even myself, I actually buy the physical paperbacks when I read, and I do a lot of reading again. And, you know, I'm always buying the physical copy because I'm on the computer all the time, that I don't want to sit in front of a screen and read the book. And so I still buy the physical copy. But in, with the Create Space, less competition because there's no keyword strategies really. You can't change your title and your subtitle without retiring your book and publishing it again. So typically when you're making the commitment into Create Space, oftentimes you're committed to it, and it's a little bit more work to update it and revise it and make it better. And so I've always gone into Create Space with having a little bit more content with my strategy. I have books that are up to 200 pages, but I'm charging, you know, up as high as $27 a paperback. Wow. Okay.
Whereas so, with Kindle, you're kind of limited because they only want you to price it from $2.99 to $9.99.
Yeah.
And everyone else is pricing it at $2.99. So you're kind of pigeonholed out in a way where you can't really make as much.
And one of the drawbacks that I've noticed with Kindle is because there's really such a small barrier to entry. You're always going to have competition, and you can still make money on Kindle. I have an ebook.
You have to start with Kindle though.
Yeah, you have to, because for you to ever get to paperback and to build your reviews, and that's what the Kindle is. Kindle's the platform to support your Audible and your paperback, because to swap those and get reviews for that would be time consuming, costly, whereas everything's attached to that ebook product.
Yeah.
And so all the work you're doing for your ebook, you're really networking and building up your product line and your paperback and your Audible and things like that. And so now my whole mentality of publishing has changed. Before I knew Kindle was a platform, but now I really understand that Kindle is the basis to get into something really big with even Create Space and Audible. Forget about even if you want to back end and optimize your books and things like that. You can just make good money. Like, I'm on pace for 14,000 this month in Create Space alone.
Wow.
So it's only taken me, you know, 6 months to surpass with less books in Create Space than all of my Kindle portfolio. Okay. So, and I know the books are good. It's just that the challenge we have with Kindle is that a lot of the consumers, because it's so easy to buy and at $2.99 price point, they're often looking at the publication date. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, they think that the newer the publication, that the more current the information is. A kind of a misconception with Kindle. And because it's so freely, you can buy it, costs nothing, $2.99. And a lot of the way Amazon's going is it probably one day will all be KUU subscribers, because why wouldn't anybody pay $10 and just have unlimited downloads?
Yeah.
Right?
So, and that the challenge is the traditional publishers are getting in fights with Amazon over that, because you know, they want to be able to price their books at a higher price point, but Amazon's driving the price down on ebooks.
Exactly. And they're pushing it down because really Kindle, Amazon KDP is their funnel, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, we've talked about this. Mm-hmm. Amazon has meticulously created this great platform that brings publishers to do all the work to put the content out there. Mm-hmm. They know all the publishers are going to do all the work promoting and driving traffic to sell their books. And then all these consumers are going to come and buy books at 99 cents, $2.99, build the trust, be influenced to get into KUU and build a better relationship with Amazon. And then what are they going to do? They're going to upsell them and buy a physical product and buy another service.
Because Amazon doesn't make any money from Kindle books.
No.
Even their Kindle devices, they take a loss on it because they're just trying to grow and acquire customers, because they know that if they get you in as an Amazon customer, you're going to buy everything. You're going to buy your groceries, you're going to buy maybe your next car or something like that.
Yeah.
Everything from Amazon.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. And so, you know, I wanted to share today because I really want to influence people in regards to, I also want to give thanks because I've coached so many people and you know, they've changed how I deal with my day-to-day, my attitude, my mindset. Surprisingly, my mindset has changed. But I also wanted to share that, you know, really Kindle, just to say to you here now, I'm a year later and I've done it all. You know, I have over 300 books published, 350. This month, I'm launching a massive launch of 150 books, 5 books a day. And I'm at that scale now, and I can publish. Now the question is, somewhere down the line, you got to question whether it's quality. You know, you're doing quantity over quality. I have a system in regards to making my product better over time. And that has allowed me to get into Create Space and get into Audible, so that when those products reach those markets, they're the best products that can be in those markets. I do take a lot more risk now. I take products and I go into the market, but I've made the money. So I test a lot more books, and which I don't always encourage. I say to people, you know what, do a couple books, do two, three, four markets. And then when that market takes off, publish more in that market and capitalize. You promote that too, right? Have more in one niche than other and create a good series and back end optimize. And I do that too. You know, I've created a massive mailing list and I haven't gotten into a lot of affiliate marketing yet. That's sort of the next step for me after physical product. But I wanted to share that, you know, with Kindle, you're going to have competition because the barrier to entry is difficult. It's challenging. You're always going to have to have be one step ahead of everyone else, whether that's reviews, whether that's content, whether that's better description or better cover. The norm has been in the last year that I have seen everybody go to Fiverr and spend $5 on a cover. But we're past that. Because you have 4,000 members, mm-hmm. all publishing books. Mm-hmm. We're past that. All the people in my program, I say, you know what? You need to spend $15 on a cover. Mm-hmm. And when that benchmark changes, then you need to spend $40 because the platform, everything is changing.
Everything better than everyone else. You always have to be one step ahead.
Exactly. The quality has to be better. The description, you got to go and get, you can't find someone overseas and spend $5 on a description. You got to sell that. If you can't write it, then you got to find someone who can market in your description because that's the only place that we have an opportunity to sell content. Mm. Everything else Amazon controls, right? They control who they sell to. They have the mailing list. They control everything. The only thing we control is getting our reviews, putting a good quality writing book up, a great cover, and our description is the only place where we can actually share what we want to share in information and sell our product.
Right.
And I've coached over and over again, and I've seen people, and their descriptions are like long. It's like you just pump a bunch of content in there, and all of a sudden your book's going to sell. Well, that actually hurts your book. Mm. Because if they see a description and it's not good, what are they going to think about the rest of the book?
Totally.
Yep. Right? And so, you know, the norm has been spend $50 on writing. Well, no, I encourage people in my program to spend $70, $80. Mm-hmm. Right? Get good quality writing, you know, and go above and beyond because now you're going to be a step ahead. And by the time you guys all watch this video, you might set that threshold and it's going to change.
Yeah, I think that's important because I think there's a certain percentage of people that just do the bare minimum, right? And you can get okay or mediocre results with that. Just doing the bare minimum, you know, doing a bare minimum quality of a book, the length of a book, bare minimum in terms of the cover, bare minimum in reviews. And I see that all the time, drives me crazy where people, they just get like 5 Amazon reviews for their product and stuff. But what you're saying, the one thing that's made you different and also a lot of people that you've coached, and I've noticed this as well with people that are more successful, is they're willing to do more than everyone else.
Yeah.
They're willing to invest more in their book, invest more in their cover, get more reviews.
Yeah.
And I think the core thing from this too that I've learned is taking this seriously. Because I think a lot of people pursue Kindle publishing just kind of as a hobby. I want to see if this like maybe kind of works or whatever.
Yeah.
But you have to approach it as a business.
Yeah.
And as a business, you can't be afraid to invest money into something as a startup cost to be successful at it.
Exactly. And I've been fortunate because the program that I've developed is people that really want to learn business. And that's what I focused my whole program on, is that, yeah, I'm going to give you the tools to automate this business. I'm going to give you the tools to be a good publisher and focus on things that in regards to your upscaling and automating, but I'm going to give you the tools to treat this as a business. I'm going to tell you exactly how to think like a business person, because every decision you make is a product and you're making an investment, whether it's time, energy, or money. Right? Because every time you decide to publish a book, you need to understand that if you want that book to have success, then you need to give it everything. And that has to be the same for every book. Now that's challenging when you get to 100, 200, 300 books. So you need to automate it. You need to get the support to be able to continue that flow with every single book. And so, you know, I've enjoyed the last year has been, you know, amazing in regards to what I've learned online. Kindle has provided me with the knowledge to develop software, which we can talk about with the K-Optimizer that we did together. It got me into the mastermind that we recently did. What experience that was. And, you know, it got me into CreateSpace and Audible. I just launched my first hardcover that I showed Stefan and CD.
Yeah.
So now you go to my books and you see all 5 platforms. Yeah. You know, to purchase your
paperback, hardcover, audiobook, CD, and Kindle.
I don't think there's anything else. Maybe if you could attach a physical product to it, maybe one day, I don't know. But I've covered every angle. Yeah. You know, I've now started experimenting with other platforms like Barnes & Noble and Ingram Sparks and Lightning Source. You know, these types of, and Lulu.com, which are other platforms that compete with Amazon, just to see what kind of market is. But that is being someone who wants to stay a step ahead. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. right? I didn't get complacent and just said, okay, I'm going to stay with Kindle and I could probably grow this to $10,000, $20,000 a month. I knew, I got into CreateSpace and I started to see, wow, CreateSpace has more potential than Kindle. Mm-hmm. Bigger market, you know, much more books, less competition. Even though there's more books and there's competition, less competition in regards to, you don't got to worry about keywords because you're only attaching five, one category. There's no keywords in your series. You can't really do a keyword strategy in your title and subtitle because that's already been established in your ebook, right? So there's not people doing keyword strategies in CreateSpace because they've started with Kindle typically, mm-hmm. right? Audible, a whole new market. I think Audible is definitely the future. You know, it's probably going to be 10 years from now where Kindle is now, where it's just growing massively. It is, it's got some barriers. It takes forever to get the book live on Audible. But once it goes there, it's truly passive income. Like, we don't build reviews. We don't change our content. We don't do descriptions. The description's pulled from the website. Everything's...
I think that's the great thing is when you're doing Audible and CreateSpace, you're leveraging all the work that you've done for that one Kindle book. So you're only making that primary initial investment in getting the book written and getting the cover done.
Exactly.
Then you can take that, and then the transition to CreateSpace is very inexpensive.
Just format it.
And then the transition to Audible, you do need a voice person to help you with that and stuff, but you can get that done inexpensively as well. But then you're leveraging your content and all the reviews that you've already established for your Kindle book. So you don't have to go out there and get more and more reviews for it, because the reviews that you got for Kindle shows up on Audible as well as CreateSpace.
Exactly. So what you're really doing is you're networking.
Yeah.
You're building your Kindle. That's your foundation. And all the work you put into that, it networks everything else.
And you're diversifying.
Yeah, too,
because
definitely.
Some months, you know, in some ways, you know, Kindle books, your rankings might drop. You might, you know, lose a little bit of sales, but, you know, you could be making a lot of money on CreateSpace, Audible. So you're basically now taking, if that original Kindle book made you, you know, $50 or $100 per month, now you've grown the amount of value and the income that book is providing you to maybe up to $200 or more per month.
Yeah, exactly. Right? And you know, another reason why I wanted to do this is also to share that, you know, this is a business and it requires work. I have so many students that come to me or people join my program, and I've coached them, you know, minimum 2 months and then greater. And you know, it's pretty obvious and apparent which members are going to achieve $5,000 or $10,000. And I've had a number of them share in KMM that have achieved that. But they're devoting their life to it. They've worked hard. Mm-hmm. You know, they've spent time. And the great thing about Kindle is that the more time you spend, actually, the more money you can make.
Right.
Right. And so it's apparent because most of the students that or the members that I've had that have reached that 5,000, 10,000. I just had another one send me a message today and said he reached 5,000 in 4 months. And for him, who came to me with no books and to have, I think he has like 30 something books, 32 books. Wow. He understands product quality. Mm-hmm. You know, he has done that. He's taken everything that I've shared with him in those 4 months of coaching and he's implemented it bang on, and he's focused on quality. And I'm going to explain one thing about quality. I shared with you recently my top selling book. Okay. I mean, I've told you about it, and it did $2,100 in sales last month. Mm-hmm. That book is a true passive income tool. I've had it now for 11 months and it has increased every month making sales. Now, mm-hmm. a large part of that is not because I left it. That book has over 200 reviews. That book is a fifth edition. Mm-hmm. That book has 200 pages. That book has a paperback attached to it, Audible attached to it. It did almost 800, wow. 800 in ebook sales last month, and it did 1,300 or 1,400 in CreateSpace, selling at $27 a book.
Wow.
It hit Audible 3 days ago. 3 days ago. And I've sold 20 copies.
Wow.
At $15.
That's awesome. So you didn't start off though with
no.
a 200 page book?
No. It was just a simple book.
Yeah.
24 pages.
Yeah.
And I knew exactly how to make that book better based on the market telling me how to make it better.
Right.
And that's the great thing with the review service, because they tell you, hey, we don't like this, we don't like that. And then you focus on it, you build it.
I think that's a key thing, because I see a lot of people, they go through K-Money Mastery and they're like, okay, I'm just going to do the bare minimum. I'm going to do a book for $50 or whatever. They put it up there. And then, you know, maybe they get a negative review, which pretty much every book does at some point, but they're not improving it.
No.
They don't do anything to make it better. And that's one of the core things that I say. In fact, I actually re-updated K-Money Master, and I think the second video in the program is like the importance of quality, because I saw so many people doing that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I don't want my program to contribute a bunch of crap out there. I want to emphasize for people that, you know, in order for you to be successful at this, you've got to invest more in your books and make them better over a period of time. But when you first start out, you don't need to have a 200-page book or invest thousands of dollars in a book. You do want to, you know, be careful about that and not invest too much. That way there's not as much of a risk. But once you know that your book is selling, you do want to improve it, make it better so it's a quality book. Because if you only do, if you do a crappy book, it's going to make you money for a month, 2 months, 3 months.
That's it.
And then it's going to die. If you improve your book, then it's going to be sustainable over the long term. So I really wanted to emphasize that and put that out there.
And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to share, because, you know, I get people come, they got 100 books and I'm looking at all their books and I'm like, you got 10 reviews, this book's a year old. How did you expect to like continue your sales?
Yeah.
You've just, okay, a lot of people need to understand that, okay, how Amazon works. And I think there's a little bit of unclarity in regards to this. When you launch a book, Amazon fudges your rankings. Okay, they basically say, okay, you're a new publisher, you got a new book, we're gonna help you out. Okay, and we're gonna launch your book, we're gonna give you some extra points on your keywords. Look at your keywords as a point system, okay? And there's different ways to get points on your book. You can get it from a sale on your keyword in your title, on your subtitle, a verified review, an unverified review, a traffic that comes out of Amazon, an organic search on your keyword, going through a category search. There's all these ways that Amazon, and they've all like ranked them and say, okay, well, our number one thing is we want traffic coming to Amazon. So if somebody buys your book coming outside of Amazon, you're gonna get a bunch of points, and we're gonna rank your product better. So there's all these types of strategies that you can do to rank your product better. But at the very beginning, Amazon's manipulating that. And so if you go and launch your book in a 60,000 market, okay, and you're focused, all your keywords are focused on these massive markets, well, Amazon's fudged your book, right? And they've landed you on the top three pages. And typically people, as we know, will buy off those top three pages. So you all of a sudden are making a lot of money on your books. Okay, and you're great, I'm making $400 my first month, $500, this is gonna be like this forever. Well, no, because at some point, Amazon says, oh, we're not gonna help you anymore. We're gonna take those points back and say, okay, well, we're gonna help the next publisher. We've given you a jump start. Right. Obviously, you're making money. They understand all this. Their algorithm factors everything in, right? But then what happens is, okay, you're getting reviews and you're putting your book through promotion. So you're kind of extending that life of surviving into your second month, and you're getting more reviews in your promotion. And so all these things are extending it, but you're kind of hiding the real problem here. The real problem is you wouldn't even be there if Amazon didn't help you rank there.
Right.
Okay. And then when that all ends, when all your options end and you have to wait till your next 90 days to do your promotion, all of a sudden your book starts to slide. Because remember, Amazon is doing the same thing on other books. And I'll give you an example. In my program, in my second session, I share understanding large niches and small niches, attacking the strategy behind both. And I use the example money market. And there's, I did one session this morning and it was 34,000 books in the market. When I started this program 6 months ago, I shared the exact same niche, 28,000. So we are talking about 6,000 books being published in 6 months in that market. That's 1,000 books a month.
Right, in the market money?
Money.
For the keyword.
Keyword.
Okay.
Now you tell me how you're gonna survive in that market, just having a 24-page book with 10 reviews and whatever. Even if you had a 200-page book and you had Audible and CreateSpeed, you still won't survive because you've only got 10 reviews to support it. So you tell me how you can survive in that market. You've got 35 books a day being published, all getting the same benefit that you just got an hour ago when you published your book. You have permanently free books in these markets. You have 30 something thousand other books that are gonna go on promotion. You've got books like Tony Robbins, and you got celebrities, and you've got established books that have been there for 2 or 3 years and making sales. How are you gonna survive? Right. So I don't encourage people to go after these big markets, go after smaller markets and then grow your business. And then when your book is established, like what I've done with my top selling book, that now what I said, 2,100, is on pace for 3,000 this month. Right. I can go after big markets because I have 200 reviews. I got 200 pages of content. I've got hardcover, paperback, Audible, CD. I got everything behind it so that when the consumer buys this product, they have all the options. It's a legitimate passive income tool. And that's what we're trying to, I mean, isn't that why we go into this business?
Totally.
To create a true passive income tool. But to do that, you need quality.
Yeah. And I want to take a step back a bit because I think there's a bit of a misconception. Because I think, you know, you, as you and I both know, people get into K-Money Mastery, they join your coaching program, and, you know, they're brand new, and they say, okay, I want to do what you did. I want to make $20,000 in a month. But they don't really know the work or the system or the foundation you need to have in place to get to that level. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people have unrealistic expectations in some ways, and they don't understand the commitment to it. Now, most people that join Key Money Mastery or coaching, whatever, most people, you know, they're brand new. They've never done an internet business before. And most people, they have already a full-time job, mm-hmm. right? It's not like they have, you know, 10 hours, 12 hours a day to focus on and build this. But you want to maybe share a little bit of like what was involved in terms of the work, the systems, like what it takes to scale up to that point.
Yeah, yeah. Now,
working with other people.
Yeah, I mean, almost everybody has a job when they've come to me. Now, the great thing about my program, it is a high ticket price, you know, to get in. So I know that the people that are spending that money and getting in are dead serious. They're not going to shell out $2,000 plus to get into my program and then just kind of not spend time on it.
Right.
They're willing to put in the effort. So that kind of eliminates the barrier for me.
I found, just on a point on that, that's actually a very important point. I've noticed that when people don't invest much into something, they don't take it as seriously.
Yeah.
When they actually have more skin in the game and they invest more money or whatever, they take it to a way different level in terms
of seriousness. So I wanted that. I want to deal with people who are motivated, who want to change their life, who are, you know, want to make a difference. They want to apply the time. They're not lazy. They're going to work hard. They're passionate about it. This is what they want. Nobody goes and spends that kind of money if that's not what they want to do. Now, I've had a few people that come and realize how much work it is and drop out of the program. And that's fine. That's going to happen because really, you really need to know what you're getting yourself into if you're going to do this business. Now, that's not to say that you got to limit yourself to do Kindle. This could just be a learning experience for you to get into something so much bigger.
And like, it doesn't mean, I mean, this is only if you want to go to that level. Some people are comfortable just making $500 a month, right?
Oh, yeah.
And that doesn't take much to do. You don't need to, you know, spend exuberant amounts of hours and stuff to do that. So as long as you're comfortable, but it depends on the results that people want to get. Right?
Exactly, right? And of course, the motivation here is that when they come and they start doing well, and they start seeing success, they're motivated for more.
Yeah.
And they'll be willing to give more. And that's why I think my program and your program has done well, is because when people start to invest their time and they start to see some success, they start to invest more in time. And that's the reward. That's the great thing about Amazon, is they've made this platform for you that if you give more, you can be rewarded more. Now, having said that, you also have to be smart. You also, it comes down to making good investment decisions, knowing marketing, knowing business, because you need to have everything to be able to run this into a decent business, okay? Or make it profitable business. If you're happy with $500, you probably don't need a lot of marketing. You probably don't need a lot of business. Now, myself, I'm just dealing with people that are very serious. They want to upscale, they want to automate, they want to make $10,000, $20,000 a month, right? I have one student who did $30,000, wow. Right? And so, you know, he's managed to take everything. I mean, he was doing 13,000 when he came to me, right? But I shared, you know, what I've done, and he's taken it and he's blown it to 30,000. Wow. He said he did in January. Okay, so it works. What I'm teaching in regards to your fundamentals and teaching your foundation and then automating it. The automating is so important, because really, how would I be able to control 300 books if I didn't have a system based on VAs and automating that through the way that I've done it in my structure, that they basically do Kindle. I spend very little time on Kindle, right? I spend most of my time now I do spend a lot of time on CreateSpace and Audible.
So you've built a team of virtual assistants, VAs, that allow you. So for example, you know, when you first started, you started with maybe two books, right?
Yeah,
but then you slowly started doing more and more books, 10 books, 20 books, publishing in a given month or whatever it is. But in order for you to launch those books, you know, you need to be able to get a lot of Amazon reviews for all those different books, to be able to rank all those books. So it becomes a little bit more complicated. And I kind of use the example that if, you know, you're a contractor and if you're building a house, a lot of people, they try to do 10 houses at once, but they don't have all the trades.
Yeah.
They don't have all the systems. And it's like,
but not even that. A lot of people don't realize is as you upscale, a lot of businesses fail because they have a great idea, but they don't have the cash flow, or they don't have the business sense in regards to when an opportunity comes, mm-hmm. when to jump on it, because mm-hmm. they're distracted by the whole big picture.
Right.
One thing that I'm very, very good at is that, yeah, I can spread out and I can publish, like this said, this month, 150 books, but I have a plan of action that when I see a signal that one or 10 or 15 or 20 or 100 of those books show signs of life, we're right on it. My whole team is right on it, taking it to the next level, improving the book, getting more reviews than what was planned originally, you know, coming up with a different strategy in regards to how much you're going to promote it, whether you're going to take the next level and do, press releases or Twitter marketing or whatever.
Right.
Right. We've got a protocol for an initial book that we put out.
Right.
But then we've got a whole bunch of planning that we do that when that book takes off,
right.
and we can capitalize, basically squeeze a dollar out of a nickel.
Right.
Right. And that's what we're doing. Now, I focus on quality. I do my best to have every book. There are books that, squeak through the cracks like any business that probably get neglected. Right. And I do my best to try to do that. I keep working on my team in regards to adding new members to focus on and making it more and more automated so that doesn't occur. But it happens. It's business. Right. I mean, you're going to have some loopholes. But I focus on quality. It's gotten me where I am today. It's allowed my create space to take off and my Audible to take off.
So I just want to be clear, because I want to make sure it's not too advanced for people that are brand new to
program
and stuff.
No.
So basically, you're not doing everything yourself. You've hired virtual assistants from people that you're hiring from the Philippines, and you're paying them, $3 an hour or whatever. And they're basically, you're basically now outsourcing your Kindle books, your Kindle covers, your promotions, your Amazon reviews,
everything.
You're submitting to directories, Facebook, Twitter, press releases. And your role in this business is what?
My role in my business is the ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Is continue come up with the ideas and the strategies to develop more and more. To find ways to automate it more, to expand, to get into hardcover. It allows me the time to use my skill set, my asset. And that is the ideas and the managing. That's what I'm good
at. And you even have a manager.
I have a couple of managers.
Manages the virtual assistants and stuff.
So, exactly.
What allows you now to scale up to this point and beyond is because he's built that.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the core things.
Well, I was fortunate too, because when I was searching for my VAs, as you all know, it is a challenge managing people and finding the right VAs to work for you. I was able to track down a VA that had a team of VAs.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a company, like an IT company.
Right.
And I was able to approach that VA and say, okay, well, come work for me and we'll train your whole staff.
Mm.
And to do my job. And so I instantly inherited a company that could take over. But you see, that's the innovation that I have, right? That's what I'm always looking. I'm always trying to stay one step ahead to build my business quicker and faster,
mm-hmm.
right? So I did that. And I encourage that with many times in my group. I'll say, ask, you've done that. Ask friends, ask brothers, ask sisters. Mm-hmm. So you eliminate that time of having to source out, finding VAs.
Because
it will become challenging at some point when you need 10 or 15 VAs if you've got 200 books. But you don't even need, even in my program, I'm not saying you have to come to me or even Stefan KMM and publish. We had one student that came to the mastermind that's in my program. What did he have? Like 22 books? And he was already at $2,000,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
right? And I mean, he was on pace. I had another student that just shared this morning, 32 books making $5,000.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't need a lot of books,
right?
Myself, I'm doing it because I have the ability to. If I hadn't automated it and hadn't created a system where I can just put a book in there and it's from there, it just takes it all the way to hardcover and Audible and CD and whatever else it wants, I probably wouldn't have done it.
Right.
Right. But I figured out a way. That was a skill that I had based on all my experiences in previous business, that I could take something so small and automate it. So really the sky's the limit in regards to how far I want to take it. Maybe I'll have 1,000 books by the end of the year and my system can support it.
Mm. Right. The people that you're working with in coaching. And by the way, when we first did our original interview, that was at the time, actually, you came to me, you're interested in doing coaching because that was something that you're passionate about.
Oh,
you
I
wanted
love it.
To teach and everything. And now, since then, you mentioned you've coached over 50 different people.
Easy.
And, if you're part of K Money Mastery and the Full Disclosure Group, there's always people that are posting the results and sharing it.
Yeah.
And it's been great. And I think that's one of the reasons why you've been successful, because you've gotten people results beyond just the video training and everything. And so when you get results, you get testimonials, you get referrals, just the same way you built your construction business as well. So you've now helped all these people. What have you learned in that time in terms of maybe some of the mistakes people make, or what's the difference in terms of what makes someone successful?
The biggest thing is mindset. Okay, you know, I have almost 60 people in my program now, and so I've coached that plus single sessions. I've coached more than quite a few, and it's pretty apparent. There's different types of people. There's people that, you know, I've noticed that have a mindset that are very motivated, but need direction. There are people that will go to the ends of the earth. They're motivated and they know direction. They just need guidance, right? They just need a path. But once you put them on that path, they can take off. And I've had students like that. They're already very smart. Mm-hmm. They just need to know where to start. And then as things go along, to guide them back on track. But one thing that I've noticed is mindset. It's just such a massive topic. I think people's mindset really either allows them to achieve or not to achieve. And I've had students come to me and they've done, you know, one session. I've encouraged them, okay, go publish a book based on everything we've taught. And then in the second session, they come back and I'm quitting. This is not for me. Mm-hmm. I can't do it. And I'm like, hey, well, let's take a step back. What's wrong? What's the problem here? Well, I didn't make any money. I've only had two organic sales. And I'm like, okay, well, where's your book at? Well, I'm just setting it up for promotion. I'm like, okay, well, what are you expecting? I mean, you went out, you got some reviews, you've got 6-7 reviews, you've put it now to $299, you're waiting on your promotion. You've already got two organic sales. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, really, you're not really going to see any real result.
Well, they thought they're just going to press a button and magically they're going to get rich.
Exactly, right? And it's just mindset. And I have students who, you know, members who procrastinate. You know, that you give them a task and it's like, oh, well, you know, I got procrastinated. I didn't do this and I didn't do that. And I have one student, greatest guy in the world, okay? And he's been very successful. He's created a service. And you know, in regards to that, and he's reached his milestones. And it took him longer than most people, but he had a procrastination issue. And I said to him, okay, well, you know, out of all the 4 months I've coached you, okay, the one thing that is I've known that you've been motivated is the fact that you work out. You work out like religious, like your health is your life. That's like, no matter how crappy you feel, no matter what's going on in your life, you're always devoted to going and working out. And he's like, well, yeah, of course, it's my health. And I'm like, well, why is that mindset so obvious for you and not in the rest of your life? And he said, well, never really thought of that. And I said, well, if you relate to health, if that's where your brain clicks, there's like a button there that says, okay, well, when somebody talks about health, I'm instantly alert. Because that's my passion. Okay, well, let's twist this then. Let's change your mindset and understanding that everything else in your life is related to health too. And he goes, well, what do you mean? And I said, well, okay, you procrastinating in your business, in your life, is actually very unhealthy, don't you think? Well, yeah, I said, it stresses you out. It doesn't achieve your goals, so it makes you sad, brings you down. It does all these types of things to your body and to your and to how you feel in achieving your goals in life. And he said, well, wow, I never looked at it that. And all of a sudden, it was like a light bulb went off in the guy. And like, he had about a month left in his program. And it was like, never seen the guy work so hard in a month. And he achieved his goal of making the money. He had great things happen. Because that's the great thing, is that when a light bulb goes off and you start putting yourself out there like you should be, and how you are, and giving it everything, then all of a sudden, great things start to happen in your life. And you know, he got a book that ranked like 11th or something on a free promotion. I never even heard of that. Like, my best I've ever had was 16. Mm-hmm. And I have a whole bunch of strategies behind it. Mm-hmm. And you know, he did 11th and he sold like $400 on coming off a promotion and all these great things. And he was reaching milestones. And all of a sudden now he's like devoted. Mm-hmm. I mean, and he's been out, he's in the forum still, but he's not in my program, but I keep in touch with him. But you know, he's still going strong. But you see, it was the mindset had to be tricked to realize that, you know what, everything else around me does affect my health, because that was his button, that was his trigger. And that's what everybody needs to find. They need to find that trigger that gets them to get on path, to get focused, and to have a positive attitude. And that's how it's changed me, is that, you know, in coaching, I've coached all these people and I've heard all their remarkable stories and how hard they work. I have students that, you know, go to the ends of the work, world. Like, you know, they're working in the middle of the night and they're just like devoted their life because they really want to change their life.
Yeah.
And they're going to do it. I know they will, right? Because I'm going to do everything I can to help them do that. And, you know, when you work with somebody like that, that's doing all that, it really is, I feel fortunate that I'm actually saying or doing or showing and having an impact on that. So my mindset has changed in the sense that, you know, Kindle has gotten me to this, I look at it as I'm living a dream right now because I'm sharing my experiences. It's like everything I share, people want to know and I can give it to them and then they don't have to go through the pain or the learning curve's gone. I'm their learning curve, right? And so I can't express how much it's changed. That's one of the reasons why I wanted to do this video. I just wanted to say in the last 6 months, even for someone who's had success, and I've been very fortunate that all the difficulties I've had in my life, I've been able to turn them around and to be where I am today. But I still took myself out of my comfort zone, you know, and everything that I achieved. And I've done that from venture to venture and took myself out of a comfort zone, started this Kindle, and I didn't know anything. Like I knew how to do a Word document and I know how to email. Mm-hmm. Right to where the point is now where I spent 4 months with a programmer developing a software that everyone will see soon and doing that and you know just back end optimization and Audible MP3 and all these types of file formats.
We went to your very first internet marketing seminar, the Traffic and Conversion Summit in San Diego, and I've been to the seminar before and stuff, but even for you, like everything was just over your head. Like, and it just kind of goes to show, like, you didn't know half of what they're talking about and stuff, but you're learning. And
but I came home and I went to called my IT guy and I said, we're gonna do my website and we're gonna funnel traffic, right? And he's looking at me, where did this all come from, right? And I'm like, we're gonna create a mailing list and we're gonna do this and we're gonna do that and I'm gonna implement a new service in my group and I'm gonna, you know, do this. You know, it was just, I went and implemented. And I took what I could from that seminar because it was 4 days or 3 days of just too much knowledge and over my head. But I understand like pixel marketing. And I was just like, it's just this, I can't believe that a year ago.
And what is this opening up for you now? Like, where do you see the future, the potential, not just with Kindle, because you know, you're still continuing to grow Kindle, but you're also expanding now into all these different software.
And I have a number of services that I've been fortunate enough. I've in my program, there's a lot of students because my program is focused on business. I mean, that's what sets me apart is that I really focus on business. Everything that I do in my coaching sessions, I relate to real life experiences with other businesses. That's how I send the message. Yes, Kindle is the platform that allows you to publish and to make money, but eventually I want to allow you the opportunity, whoever comes to me, that you can take my knowledge or that I'm sharing with you and you can implement, whether it's in Kindle, CreateSpace, Audible, physical product, a blog, a website, whatever it is, whether it's, I've even mentored a few students who have opened physical businesses outside of online, you know, that have gone and started publishing companies for traditional for company people who don't want to do the online stuff and just things like that. And you know, one student went and started a babysitting company, right? And you know, he's gone around, he's in the military and he went around the base camp and he got his license, started a business to generate income. But you see, that is putting himself out there because the knowledge and the experience he's getting from something like that, he'll apply it to something bigger one day. And he's not going to limit himself from being an 8-to-5 job. Right, that he'll have the potential that when an idea comes to him or just in a way that he wants to control his life, he'll be able to go and implement because he's going to have that knowledge, that business knowledge.
And I think that's the key is, you know, the goal of coaching or KMM or whatever is not for you to just be a Kindle publisher. We want to make you into an entrepreneur, a business owner, somebody that has that strategy, that mindset, becomes the person that no matter what business that you get into, online or offline, you'll be successful at it because the fundamentals of business are all the same. That's why I think you've been able to take Kindle Publishing and be so successful is because you already had the business knowledge and fundamentals and experience that were able to translate. Now, a lot of people, it's their very first time starting a business.
Yeah.
And so in many ways, it can be a little bit challenging. You know, even, you know, people ask about accounting and taxes and they've never hired someone before. And there's so many elements to that. But these skills that you're learning are way beyond just publishing a book. It's helping you with marketing and all the skills of business. So I think that's a great
thing. Yeah, I mean, you kind of don't realize what you're learning with this business because you're in there and you're doing it. You're learning how to manage outsource. You're learning how to manage people, hiring, hiring, dealing with them not doing a job right, letting them go. Regards to having problems in your business and just or being able to deal with it and recover from it. These are all just valuable experiences.
Yeah, I think that one of the biggest ones is failure. Most people have never failed at anything. Yeah. And when you can always tell because if they do fail, their book doesn't sell a copy for like a day or something like that. You know, you'd always freak out.
Oh man, I get all the time. I get messages.
It's almost like people have never experienced that failure before because they've been so comfortable their entire lives having a job or whatever it is. They've never faced that adversity. And I think one of the greatest things being in business is you have to fail. There's nobody out there that's never, achieved something in business that has never failed. But those are the times where you learn the most and you become a better business owner, entrepreneur. And over time, it's like failure doesn't affect you in any way.
No, I actually, ironically and funny, I actually look for failure. Mm-hmm. There's many times that I don't purposely try to make mistakes, but I'm looking for where I make mistakes because I know how that I won't make it again. And that I know that every time I make a mistake, I can turn it into an asset. There's always way to make something positive out of something negative. Yeah. There's always a way.
Whenever I have somebody that has published a book and it doesn't sell and they failed, I say, good.
Yeah.
Good. I want you to fail because I want everybody has to go through that. They have to go through that failure. And I know that when you turn this around and you find a way to make this book sell or you learn that lesson, that you're going to have more confidence in your ability as an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
You know, my girlfriend actually the other day, she messaged me because her product wasn't selling as well on a particular day. And I said, good, I want you to go through that. Yeah. I want you to experience the failure because that's going to make you a better entrepreneur. It's like you can't shelter yourself from failure. And that's when you're going to know how committed you are.
Yeah.
That's what separates the dabblers between the people that are actually going to be successful.
My mentor, when I first went into the stock market, my very first stock I bought, I tripled my money. I invested $1,500 and I made $5,500. And my mentor said to me, he said, that was the worst thing that could have happened to you for the stock market.
Yeah.
Because now you're going to be just investing not smart. You're just going to think that you're going to make money on everything. And sure enough, I learned the hard way and made an investment and lost $10,000. Right now, but now that loss made me realize, take a step back and realize that, stock market's a risky place and you really need to. And so I invested my time, did my research and learned, and I've spent almost 10 years in regards to research constantly when it comes to investing in the market. And so, but you see, you need to experience failure. Now, if you keep making the same mistake, well, then you're not learning something. There's something wrong there. But typically, you want to make a mistake and learn from it so that you can make a better investment. I've had students who have made mistakes, got their accounts flagged or, blocked because, they just made simple mistakes. And when they go back, they say, okay, well, I lost $5,000. They terminated my account. And I said, yeah, but it's better than when you're making $25,000 a month. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's an expensive price that you've lost. Yeah.
Better learn it now.
But you learn it now because the way you were going, you weren't learning anything. You were making money, but you weren't learning. Mm-hmm. And you were just flying under the radar. Well, now you got caught. Okay, now you know how to rebound. You know what the work's involved to get to that $5,000 a month again. So now you're going to work harder because you know you can achieve it. And you're going to learn from it. So when you're making $20,000 or $25,000, you're not going to make the same mistake. Mm-hmm. You're going to have all these precautionary things in place so that you don't make that mistake. So really, it's just a learning curve. And the other thing people need to understand is that it's not necessarily you're even failing. Like you could have a book and it doesn't do well, but the reality is we don't control. That's what people don't understand is if Amazon gave us the contact details of the individual buying our book, we could sell that book. We can plan a whole marketing campaign to sell that book. And we can do that in the physical world. I can sell my renovations. I can go and sell someone a stock if I can reach them, right? And communicate them. But in Amazon, they control everything, right? They control the mailing list. They control how you're going to rank. They control whether they're going to screw up on your book and not even show it or, not link your ebook and your paperback. They control everything. Mm-hmm. They control even, when I've updated my books and realized that, they haven't added the page count. And if I hadn't even noticed, then somebody would just think it's the old book and not a 200-page book instead of a 100-page book. So they control all that and they have flaws in their whole thing. So it's not necessarily that it's your book. And on top of that, how do you know? You're not a market guru. You don't know. You haven't looked at the analytics to decide whether publishing in March is as good as publishing in June, mm-hmm. right? I mean, we can be intuitive and say, okay, well, June, July, or July, August typically wouldn't be a good month to make money on Kindle because people aren't there. It's summer months. People are traveling and doing things like that. That's intuitive. But, you know, in my business, I'm doing all that. I have staff that looks at data and looks at trends and looks at all these to allow me to continue to scale up and allow me to make better and better investments in choosing markets. That's business, right? And that's what you're going to learn over time. And not to say that you got to do that all at the beginning, but at some point, if you want to turn any business successful, you need, I mean, they do that all the time, right? If you have a business, at the end of the year, you look at your financial statements and you say, well, where did we go wrong? Where was our downtime? When did we not sell? Okay, we know we need to do promoting during those months. We didn't sell anything. That's business, right?
Awesome. So I want to wrap up soon, but you know, maybe my final question is, do you have any final advice for people just on the year that you've spent doing this now? What advice do you have people that are maybe just getting started or people that are already, you know, been doing Kindle publishing for a little while?
Yeah. Well, just go back real quick on my future because I didn't answer that. I'm getting into physical product next week, hopefully. Yep. So in April, that's the goal for me now is physical product to tackle that on. I think I've done everything I can in Kindle, CreateSpace, Audible, paperback, hardcover, all that stuff. I've done everything that I can do there. So now, you know, I'm doing coaching. I'm constantly working on my program. The investing program is expanded. I've on top of that, software, I want to develop a few more software things with you. I did the mastermind. I've done a huge amount in the last year. Yeah. I'd love to do more masterminds if Stefan's on board for that, down the road. So I got a lot on the plate, you know, I definitely software, definitely physical product. That'll probably be the big one. Mm-hmm. And then if I have success with that, then probably get into affiliate marketing. That's a whole new world in regards to that. Yeah. I have a little bit of that I've done, but not big. I haven't spent a lot of time. That's sort of my wife's thing that she's sort of focusing on. So she has a little bit of success in regards to that. But that's sort of where I'm going with that. To get back to advice, you know what? The number one thing is if you're going to do this business, reach out and get help. Because the learning curve it's a lot. I mean, there's a lot on your plate. It's not hard. I mean, you've provided everything. Mm-hmm. It's just that there's a lot more that goes to making money. Like, it depends. If your goals are $500, $1,000, you can achieve that. I don't, you know, you could do that easy in 4 or 5 months doing it on your own, the learning curve, I believe. But if you want to turn this into something bigger, whether, you know, a business that's going to generate you money that you only could imagine, and a career, I don't mean just in Kindle publishing, a career in maybe branching out into physical product, affiliate marketing, online, doing things online, then get the help. Mm-hmm. And you know, people always say, well, I've got to make the money before I invest the money. But do you make the money when you go to school or university? Because what you're really doing when you go get coaching from Stefan or you go get coaching from me is you're taking all our knowledge of the last decade, all our pains and aches, and you're compressing it and you're eliminating all that. So like I had one student say when he took my program and he renewed, he said, it's like signing up for an MBA program. And that would have cost him how much and how much education. Because even when you go to university, they're teaching you the fundamentals of everything because they're assuming that you're going to pick what you want and go down a path. Well, this program and your program are defined. We're teaching you Kindle, CreateSpace, Audible. And from there, you're going to branch out and do whatever you want. So you're kind of avoiding all that pain. So do the best to get your help. If you can't afford coaching, get accountability buddies. Mm-hmm. There's so, that community at KMM is so big that reach out, become friends with people you swap with, share with each other, you know, and shorten that learning curve, because I think the learning curve frustrates people. But more importantly, if you're making mistakes, you're not learning on your mistakes. And that's the big thing, that when you go and get help, is that you're not making the same mistakes. So that when you come to me or you come to Stefan, you have 100 books and all 100 books are the exact same mistake. And all of a sudden you tweak that and your portfolio income rises by 25%. And that, I think, is the big thing. Don't lose motivation, because a lot of it is not even just yourself. It's the fact that online with Amazon and dealing with Amazon, you just don't control everything. They do. Mm-hmm. And so don't get discouraged. Everybody can achieve. I mean, I hear it all the time, people reaching out to me. I'm lucky. I have people that are, most of them are coming, that I'm dealing with people that want to make big dollars. But I have a lot of people that have reached out and tell me that they're going to take coaching. They're just saving up. And you know what? They're doing really well already too. Mm-hmm. They just want to take it to the next level. So there's a huge success rate in KMM. There's no doubt about it. It's just what you want. It's what you want with your life. And that's the great thing. What Stefan's done is he's created those opportunities for you guys in reaching out so that, you know, Kindle doesn't have to be it for you. It can, it can be other things for you too.
Awesome. Thank you. I think this will help a lot of people. I think it'll inspire a lot of people and just kind of show what's possible. In terms of coaching, I know a lot of people ask about that, so we'll make sure to have links below. You have the different plans and packages, and also you're doing investing as well. So yep. If you guys even want help beyond Kindle, whether it's investing or it's business, Andreas is available for that as well. So I want to thank you again. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this, and we'll see you guys in the next video.